Right, so welcome back to the third episode of my beginner tutorials for Kerbal Space Program, where today we are going to have a look on how to get into orbit, which in my opinion is like the first real challenge in Kerbal Space Program, because if we remember the second video about basic rocketry, most of the things I was talking about there, like aligning your center of thrust and your center of mass and so on, is something you can figure out with a little bit of understanding about physics. Like that if this design here had only one booster attached to its bottom, it would not fly straight. So anyway, what you can see here is my most simple design to get a Kerbal into orbit and back. Because I'm doing this video now again with manned spaceflight, because I think most people, and especially most people who are new to Kerbal Space Program, will play manned. I like probes, but not everyone does. So anyway, because this is a tutorial, I like to show how to build it, and we will start with some familiar things like using the Mark 1 pod and attaching a parachute on top of it, setting it to 75% pressure for partial deployment, and attach the decoupler underneath it and stage the decoupler and the parachute at the same time. And also drain the monopropellant to save weight, because we don't need it. And next up we will attach a fuel tank, and I think in the first two videos, on the second video, the first one wasn't even building rockets, and in the second video I was only building with solid fuel engines, like basically a bit bigger fireworks on a stick. And now we will introduce liquid fuel engines, which have the engine, but the engine itself is useless, so it also needs a fuel tank. And for the uppermost stage, like this video about getting into orbit would be also the first one which does a bit more about staging. And your last stage for orbital insertion and also your deorbit burn actually is quite small, and has the, or will have the Terrier engine under it. Because the Terrier engine comes at a low thrust, but at a quite good specific impulse in the vacuum of space. Not so good at sea level, but good at the vacuum of space. This goes into rocket engineering, why it is better in space than it is at sea level, and I made a first attempt at recording this video, but drifted off a bit too much into rocket engineering, and the video was just gonna be too long. Actually, I think it was 35 minutes of my second video also was too long in my opinion. So anyway, here we have our upper stage with one, whatever it is named, relatively small fuel tank and a very efficient Terrier engine. And underneath it we will have, of course, a decoupler that gets activated together with the engine. So we will decouple whatever is underneath the decoupler and start the engine at the same moment, and build a bigger fuel tank like this. And also take the swivel engine, which, as you can see, has 215 kilonewtons compared to 60 kilonewtons of thrust, but the ISP actually is a little bit lower, and basically this is like the balance you have to find. You can have high thrust but low ISP engines, like the solid rocket or the solid boosters, solid motors, and some various possible mixtures in the liquid fuel engines, like the Terrier with low thrust but high ISP, the swivel which is moderate in both ways, or here the Reliant which has good thrust but not so good ISP. So yeah, we have these two stages, and here on the right side, on the staging overview, you can see the blue numbers with the delta V. And delta V basically tells you how much power your rocket has or how much it can accelerate. Like the uppermost stage here with the orange tank has 412 meters of delta V, but I think, yep, it's at sea level. And over 1600 meters per second of delta V in space. So this uppermost stage can accelerate your rocket by over 1.6 kilometers per second, which is, yeah, more than 5,000 kilometers per hour or 3,000 miles per hour. So yeah, this is the lower one has 1,100 meters per second, which already is quite good, but still not enough to get you into orbit. So we will have to build one more stage and use the BACC Sumper SRB for it. Again, stage the swivel engine and the decoupler at once. And so now we altogether have about or almost 4 kilometers per second of delta V, vacuum delta V, but if we go back to sea level, it's not so much. And it might be enough to get into orbit, but it will not be enough to get back. So we will set it to the double symmetry that I introduced in the first video and attach to radio couplers that we also used in the first video. And take the I think it's called hammer, so that we just attach it like this. Use the tool to move them down. Yep, now it looks good. So we still want to make it aerodynamical. Take an advanced nose cone because, I mean, there's also this much lower tech level aerodynamic nose cone, but that thing would be aerodynamic at hypersonic speeds, but not at relatively low speeds after liftoff, so we will take this one. And yeah, because, well, mostly these two side boosters are to get our rocket off the ground. So we will stage them like this. We will first fire the two boosters. When they get jettisoned, we will fire the Sumper, and then this one, that one, and off we go. We are almost ready to go now, because the two hammer boosters run into danger of crashing into each other after getting jettisoned, so we also attach this to separatrons, which also get activated when these two boosters get jettisoned. One last thing is control, because the no, I did not tell it yet. The liquid fuel engines also have the advantage of a better efficiency over the solid boosters, but their biggest advantage by far is the fact that they can be throttled up, down, can be shut down, and all most of them also are gimbaled, so you. Can steer with them, which you cannot with the solid rocket booster, so we will have to attach this fins for aerodynamic control. Let's check the staging one more time. Everything looks good to me. I will explain it again in the flight. Basically, we are ready. I don't like the futuristic spacesuit. Yeah, that will do to get into orbit. So let's head over to the launch pad. And yeah, as you can see here, it is now level 3 Kerbal Space Center, because I'm no longer recording this in career mode, but now it is sandbox mode. So anyway, let's set it to full thrust, which we will only need for the third stage, for this one. And I guess we are ready, so off we go. Fire up the hammer boosters. And after a few meters we can start to pitch, or to yaw actually, eastwards, because if we just fly up, we will fall down again, and we have to... accelerate in one direction. As you can hear, this was the Zeppelins pushing away the hammers to a safe distance. And we will now start to, or we will now fly eastwards at an increasing speed to basically move our trajectory more and more onto a long flight and not just going high. We will have to stage soon. Actually, in this way, it is a little bit unstable with the shortly after firing up the third stage, it has a bit of a tendency to go into retrograde. And anyway, you can see now we are flying more and more. Oh, geez, that's too high. We are flying more and more eastwards. And already cover a huge distance. And what will happen if we go even more eastwards? We will actually have this trajectory going around Kerbin and don't fall back to the ground anymore, which is orbit, where the centrifugal force equals the gravitational pull of Kerbin. And yep, we have reached space. Just in the third stage and keep flying with the force. And by going eastwards, we can pick up the rotational speed of Kerbin, of its rotation, and use it for our eastwards movement. And this will save us a few meters of delta V. I'm not going to like this video. No, I know it already. And what is wrong with me today? I've lost it. Yeah, anyway, let's just go to Apoapsis, to the highest point of our flight. Where you can see the flight getting longer and longer. Until now. As you can see, it just goes around Kerbin. You have seen how it got longer and longer until it missed the ground. So we are now falling without hitting the ground. And our lowest point is at 94 kilometers, which is 24 kilometers above the beginning of space, which is at 70 kilometers. If we were below that, we would hit the atmosphere would slow us down, and eventually we would fall again. But like this, we are now stable. And as I've said, the spacecraft is now moving at almost 2 kilometers per second, or 7,200 kilometers per hour. And thus it experiences a centrifugal force from the movement, which is equal to the gravitational pull of Kerbin. And so, because the two forces equal each other, they cancel them out, and you will be weightless inside. So let's go to Periapsis, and if you want to lower your orbit, if you want to go back to a lower altitude, it is most efficient to do it at Periapsis, at the lowest point, where you then just point retrograde or backwards, lower your speed. You can see how the Apoapsis is dropping. And the opposite way, if you want to increase your altitude or your height, you best do it at apoapsis by going forward or prograde, going faster, and then you raise your periapsis, which is what I've done before to circularize the opt. So let's go around here. Here, that should do it. And by now going or burning retrograde or backwards again, we can lower our speed until we hit the ground again. Should do to land in the waters of the KSC, because this Mark 1 pod does not have any landing legs or something similar. I prefer to land it in water or to splash it down. And I don't know. For me, is getting into orbit is such a basic thing that I just did it now. I just don't like how this video went, but it's not my first attempt, and I think I'm just going to stick with it now. Let's jettison on our stage, activate the parachute, and we are ready for landing. So we are now hitting the atmosphere. Actually activate the overlay of aerodynamic forces. And we are still accelerating from the fall because the air is so thin that the aerodynamic drag is neglectable. This video is the ultimate proof of being good at a game is one thing, but then being good at it and simultaneously talking in a good way is another. Jeez, I don't know if I'm going to upload it. So yeah, here you can see the this red arrow growing longer and longer, which shows the drag. And what you also can see is this, it looks like fire, but it actually isn't. From the re-entry heat, and not like the popular belief, this heat is not created by friction between the capsule and the air, but by compression, by how the capsule smashes through the air and compresses the air in front so much that it just gets so hot that it starts ionizing, which basically is the electrons escaping from the atoms. This ionizing gas then looks like this, or looks like fire, but it isn't fire. I think it's gonna be quite it's not bad, our landing spot between the Kerbal Space Center and the island airfield. The best landing I ever got was somewhere around there, immediately or directly off the coast. Because of course I like to land as close to the KSC as possible, but still in the water. Yeah. Headphone users are deaf now, sorry. Still plummeting down. Let's just time go a bit. Parachute partially deploys and is fully deployed. So, Riplock. Riplock. Kerman can gently glide down at 5.5 meters per second to soft landing after being perhaps the first Kerbal ever in orbit. I don't know. There sure has been some other Kerbals in this safe before. Because this is the safe game, or the sandbox mode safe game, which I use for uploading drafts to the Steam Workshop. I'm using a special save for that because when uploading something, I only keep the mods installed that I'm actually gonna need to upload the thing, and this might break some other save games. 70 meters to go. Landed. So we could either way recover, but I like to revert to the VAB because, as I say, it is once you figured out how to do it, getting into orbit is real, real simple. I think it's just when you're new to Kerbal Space Program. It's a bit overwhelming, and anyway, look at it, remember, and I think, yup, we are too heavy, but with a bit of fiddling and, like, reducing the amount of fuel in the right way, of course. You can build this one on a level 1 VAB, or you can build it on a level 1 VAB in career mode, and you can launch it off a level 1 launch pad. But yeah, I won't do that now. So anyway, if you liked this video, I did not, you can leave a like, and you always can feel free to subscribe to both my channels. And I'm gonna put the button to subscribe and to some other videos I'm gonna put here in the how is it called? I shouldn't make videos today. Anyway, if you liked it, leave a like or a subscription. And we will see in the next tutorial about rendezvous and docking, which I hope is going to be a bit better.